HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Great Escapes, Across the Minefields, by Pamela D. Toler and W.N. Brown, performed by Shiromi Arserio. Chapter 1. The Siege. Bir Hakeim, Libya. June 8, 1942. Susan Travers heard the whine of the approaching planes. She put on her helmet and kneeled on the floor of her dugout, waiting for the next German air raid to start. "Imagine you're in a deep underground bunker," she told herself. "Imagine your helmet is a huge metal umbrella that bombs bounce off of, like hailstones from a roof." She knew in reality that the helmet would not protect her if a bomb hit, but it was better than nothing. She had lived in a tent at other military camps, but that would have been too dangerous in this free French outpost in the Libyan desert. Her home here was a narrow trench dug into the sand. It was 10 feet long, 4 feet wide, and waist deep, big enough to hold a camp bed, a little folding chair with an attached table, and her suitcase. The walls were reinforced with sandbags to keep them from collapsing, and a thin piece of sand-colored canvas stretched over the top to protect her from the sun during the day. But it wouldn't protect her from a bomb any more than her helmet would. Right now, as she waited for another wave of the German dive bombers called Stukas to attack, she thought it looked more like a shallow grave than a refuge. Susan could hear the Stukas now, droning in the distance like a vast swarm of bees headed toward Bir Hakeim. They were the worst part of the German attacks, in her opinion. As the sound grew nearer, she felt her heart pound and her legs tremble. It seemed like the bomber's humming was inside her head. Abruptly, the sounds changed into high-pitched screams, followed by silence as the planes dived toward the earth and released their bombs. The silence was almost worse than any of the noises. 5 long seconds of quiet as bombs fell toward their targets on the ground. Susan counted the seconds in her head, the way she had when she was a little girl waiting for the lightning after a clap of thunder. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The shells hit the ground right on time, exploding with a blinding flash. The earth shuddered. Then debris and dust filled the air. "Please let it be over," she whispered. Susan knew the siege would have to end soon. General Koenig, the commander of the besieged French forces, had refused to surrender to German commander Erwin Rommel. This meant Rommel would have to come in after them. The French troops couldn't hold out much longer. Susan's garrison was running out of food, water, and ammunition. Soon they would have no choice but to give up. When the war with Nazi Germany began 3 years earlier, Susan had eagerly volunteered to help her beloved France, first as a nurse, and then as a driver. But she had never imagined that she would end up in Africa with the 1st Free French Brigade fighting to keep the Germans out of Africa. Susan and the Free French forces, under the command of General Marie-Pierre Koenig, had arrived at Bir Hakeim on February 14, 1942. After nearly 4 months in the desert, most of the soldiers wanted nothing more than to leave. But not this way. Not in defeat. Their job was to help stop the German army from advancing into Egypt. Bir Hakeim was the most remote Allied post, but now, suddenly, their encampment was the focus of Rommel's Africa Corps. Susan's garrison went from being the least important to one of the most crucial of the war. The shift happened in late May. Commander Rommel ordered his army to march in a different direction and headed straight for Bir Hakeim. For almost 2 weeks since, the Africa Corps had rained down artillery shells on the outpost. The Germans had helped as well. They had allied with the Italians, who had sent soldiers, tanks, and other equipment. Susan and her fellow soldiers were surrounded, first by a no-man's land of barbed wire and anti-tank minefields, and beyond that, the German and Italian forces. Air raids battered the French camp day and night. The fighting stopped only when a sandstorm rolled in from the desert, making it impossible to see either friend or foe. The French also had another enemy. The desert. Bir Hakeim was an old fort on a sand-blown plateau, a flat area only slightly higher than the land around it. There was no shade, and sometimes, even now in June, the temperature reached as high as 120 degrees Fahrenheit during the day. At night, when the sun went down, the temperature fell below freezing, and the soldiers shivered in their dugouts. Now, when the dust from the air raid settled, Susan looked out of her dugout to see where the bombs had fallen. The mobile van that served as the general's headquarters was untouched. So was the officer's kitchen, which was only halfway underground. The general's cook poked his head out of the kitchen tent. He looked up at the sky, listening for the sound of returning Stukas. When it seemed to be all clear, he hurried towards Susan with a small box in his hands. "For you." He thrust the box at her. "The general asked me to give you some of his special rations. No sense leaving good food for the Germans." He hurried back to the kitchen without waiting for Susan to say thank you. Susan took a quick peek. Canned asparagus and sardines. That would be a nice change from tack biscuits and the canned corned beef the soldiers called bully beef. Susan looked at the sky, the same way the cook had. She wondered if she still had time before the Stukas came back. No sign of them yet, she thought. Susan crawled out of her dugout and ran to the large sloping pit where she kept General Koenig's car. As the general's driver, she had her own important job to do. Make sure the car was always ready to go. While gunfire roared on the camp's perimeter, she dug the car out of the sand with her hands, started it, and let it run for a few minutes. Over the sound of the car engine, Susan heard the Stukas again. "Back already," she muttered. She shut off the car and ran for her dugout. Once there, she kneeled on the floor again and whispered the Travers family motto as the hum of the Stukas came closer. "Nec temere, nec timide." Neither afraid nor timid. She'd learned the motto from her father, who had served in World War I, and she had always been determined to live up to it, no matter what. It was thanks to her commitment to the motto that she'd wound up in Africa in the first place. Whenever possible, she had chosen to move towards service in action, even if that meant danger instead of safety. The Axis versus the Allies. The nations that fought in World War II, 1939 to 1945, were divided into two groups. Germany, Italy, and Japan formed the Axis powers. All three countries wanted to expand their power. Germany wanted to control all the European countries in which German-speaking people lived. Italy wanted new colonies in Africa. Japan wanted to build an empire in Asia. As the war went on, some people from countries conquered by the Axis powers fought on their side, including Vichy France. The other side, known as the Allies, was made up of countries that wanted to defend themselves against Axis expansion. At the beginning of the war, Britain, the countries of the British Empire, including India, Canada, and Australia, and France, led the war against the Axis powers. As Germany conquered more of Europe, different groups of European refugees, including Poles, Dutch, and the Free French, joined the war on the side of the Allies. China was also an important member of the Allies in the war in Asia. The United States joined the war on the side of the Allies in December 1941. The Soviet Union signed a treaty with Germany shortly before the war began. The two countries promised not to attack each other and divided Europe into separate spheres of influence. In June 1941, Hitler broke his treaty promises and launched a massive invasion into Soviet territory. The Soviet Union then joined the Allies. The United States entered the war on the side of the Allies after the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, a U.S. naval base in Hawaii, on December 7, 1941. Chapter 2: A Country at War. France, June 1939. 3 years earlier. Susan could not believe what Agnes was telling her. Conditions in Vienna must have gotten worse in the 15 months since the Nazi army marched across the Austrian border. Susan read the letter again. Dear Susan, you know I'd love to see you, but this year it's just too dangerous. Austria isn't the same anymore. The German flag with its swastika hangs everywhere, even in the window of our favorite cafe. The one that had those delicious pastries, back before butter and flour were rationed. These days we are lucky to get coarse bread to eat with thin soup. The Gestapo is in charge here now. The Nazis do what they please, take what they please. People are snatched from their homes and never seen again. Not only the Jews, but anyone who disagrees with the Nazis. Even writing this to you is risky. Everyone says things will get worse if Hitler invades Poland, and it is just a matter of time before he does. We are thinking about leaving while we still can. Love, Agnes. Susan put down the letter and stared out her hotel window at the Paris street below. It all looked so normal. People were hurrying through the streets on their daily errands, as if there were no threat of war. But her friends were all in agreement and afraid. They'd written from Germany, Austria, Czechoslovakia, and Hungary, warning her not to come for her annual visits. They were probably right. So what do I do? She wondered. Susan had planned to spend the summer of 1939 the same way she had spent the last few summers, traveling across Europe, visiting friends, and playing in tennis tournaments. It didn't look like that was an option this year, now that Hitler was in power. I could go back to England, she thought. She could stay with her parents in the country house where she visited them every year for a few difficult weeks at Christmas. Not a good choice. Or better yet, she could stay with Aunt Hilda in London. She always had a good time with Hilda. But Hilda's apartment was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.